continue singing together. Here we go. Let the redeemed.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. I'm redeemed. I'm redeemed. Praise the Lord. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. I'm redeemed. I'm redeemed. Praise the Lord.
And all the people said,
amen.
Amen. You can be seated. You know, this is the time of our service where we remember what Christ did on Calvary for us, and we do that each and every week when we gather around the Lord's table. And to prepare to partake this morning, I want to share with you from 1 Corinthians 10:16, and then we'll be singing together, Are You Washed in the Blood? Is not the cup of thanksgiving for which we give thanks a participation in the blood of Christ? And is not the bread that we break a participation in the body of Christ? Are you washed in the blood?
I would like to share with you what we call the founder's note. It is found in the brochure for our LCC Tour golf outing that we played last Saturday at Raccoon International Golf Course. The founder of the tour is someone we all know, Mr. Kevin Hall. I hope that none of us take Kevin's amazing gift and talent for granted. He is so good with words and actions. And I truly appreciate what he does for me and the leadership he provides. We had 28 players at the outing this year that had the chance to read Kevin's note, but I wanted you to hear it as well. Again, it's called the Founder's Note. What's your handicap? Mine is 10 strokes for 9 holes. Better than it was last year, but still not very good. I still need a lot of help. This is one of the things I love most about this scramble format. I have 3 teammates. Together, we take turns carrying and helping each other. I don't have to go it alone today. That being the case, I will have more fun and my score will be better. This is one of the things I love most about our summer LCC Tour Golf League. I appreciate that our guys can be competitive without being cutthroat. They can battle me on the course and yet help me with my game at the same time. This is definitely one of the things I love most about God. He helps me. He instructs me. He fills in the gaps and the voids. He provides so much that I know I could not achieve on my own. In faith, as in golf, I am trying to improve. I want to be more consistently able, but it sure is nice to know He's there to provide what I lack. Makes life more enjoyable all the way around. End quote. I completely agree with what Kevin said. I too love the scramble format and seeing how low of a score that four guys can possibly get to as a team, rather than playing as individuals all the time. I love how our teammates fill that void if you happen to hit a poor shot. More often than not, one of the teammates step up and deliver a good shot to fill the void for the team. Jesus filled the biggest void imaginable in our lives. Sin is kind of like a bad shot in life. Jesus stepped up like the perfect teammate and took our sin from us when He died on the cross. Our sins were wiped clean, and we can get back on track if we turn from the sin that so entangles us and work to do better, and have faith in Jesus that He will come through for us as He always does. Romans 3:21-26 states, "But now apart from the law, the righteousness of God has been made known, to which the law and the prophets testify. This righteousness is given through faith in Jesus Christ to all who believe. There is no difference between Jew and Gentile, for all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, and all are justified freely by His grace through the redemption that came by Christ Jesus. God presented Christ as a sacrifice of atonement through the shedding of His blood to be received by faith. He did this to demonstrate His righteousness, because in His forbearance He had left the sins committed beforehand unpunished. He did it to demonstrate His righteousness at the present time, so as to be just and the one who justifies those who have faith in Jesus. The emblems that are about to be passed represent the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our perfect teammate, that freed us from our sin. He gets us out of every bad lie, every hazard, and helps us deal with every possible struggle that we might face. May we always focus on working to live the life set out for us and know that He is there for us whenever we may need Him. We just have to ask. May the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be pleasing in Your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer." Let's pray.
Thank You, Lord, for that great sacrifice that You made for us all. Please bless us as we remember that sacrifice through partaking in this communion, and help us to be mindful as we do so. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let's continue to worship this morning. If you'll be standing with me, I'm going to share with you from Psalms 103, verse 11 and 12. "For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is His love for those who fear Him. As far as the east is from the west, so far has He removed our transgressions from us."
Here I am, Lord, and I'm drowning in Your sea of forgetfulness. The chains of yesterday surround me. I yearn for peace and rest. I don't want to end up where You found me, and it echoes in my mind, keeps me awake tonight. I know You cast my sin as far as the east is from the west, and I stand before You now as though I've never sinned. But today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from Your leaving me this way. Jesus, can You show me just how far the east is from the west? 'Cause I can't bear to see the man I've been rising up in me again. In the arms of Your mercy I find rest, 'cause You know just how far the east is from the west. from one scarred hand to the other. I start the day the war begins, endless reminding of my sin. Time and time again, your truth is drowned out by the storm I'm in. Today I feel like I'm just one mistake away from you leaving me this way. Jesus, can you show me just how far the east is from the west? 'Cause I can't bear to see the man I've been rising up in me again. In the arms of your mercy I find grace. 'Cause you know just how far the east is from the west, from one scarred hand to the other. I know you've washed me white, turned my darkness into light. I need your peace to get me through, to get me through. One scarred hand to the other.
Just how far the east is from the west. Just how far.
One scarred hand to the other.
Just how far the east is from the west. Just how far.
From one scarred hand to the other.
All the people said,
amen.
Amen. You can be seated.
Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
Got to pull it up on my handy dandy phone. Alrighty. So I actually am using an article today. I just think it's awesome to like read about like other people's stories that they've had where God has just really worked, and you can see the real power that he has. So this article is titled Five Modern Day Church Offering Talks, written by Ryan Nelson. And the following is just one of the five different topics he covers. And I love seeing how awesome it is hearing or reading about all the ways that God has worked in people's lives. This article has one of these stories that I find so inspiring. So in the midst of a very severe trial, their overflowing joy and their extreme poverty welled up in rich generosity. For I testify that they gave as much as they were able, and even beyond their ability, entirely on their own. They urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service to the Lord's people, and they exceeded our expectations. They gave themselves first of all to the Lord, and then by the will of God, also to us. That's 2 Corinthians 8:2-5. So Melissa Smith beat cancer twice in her 20s, but the high doses of chemotherapy caused her to develop a rare neurological condition called transverse myelitis. It left her paralyzed from the waist down, and she was told she'd never walk again. Her limited mobility forced her to quit nursing school, and her third floor apartment, which she couldn't afford to move out of, transformed into a prison. Melissa was only in her early 30s, but the future was bleak. After watching her sister win two battles against cancer, Stephanie Smith couldn't stand by and watch her be defeated by hopelessness. She launched a GoFundMe campaign and reach out to Chive Charities, a group dedicated to campaigning causes like Melissa's and getting communities to rally behind individuals in need. Stephanie and Chive raised more than $400,000 from donors. And for a time, there was about $837 pouring in every minute. When you only think about the resources you have, it's easy to feel like you can't make a difference. But as we see in 2 Corinthians, and as we learn through Melissa's story, generous communities can have a huge impact, even when we don't have much to offer as individuals. No matter how much you have to give, God will use it. Let us pray.
Our gracious Heavenly Father, we're thankful, Lord, that we can give back to you in our time, talent, and service, you know, to you, Lord. We pray, Lord, that the gifts given today would be pleasing and acceptable in your sight, and that we'd be used to further your kingdom here on earth. We ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Father God, again, we come humbly before you, and we bring all that we have and all that we are for your strength and power, for your leading, your grace. We know that we depend upon you to forgive us daily, and we strive to likewise be forgiving of those, whether we're related or strangers. We pray that you will strengthen us for today, for the week ahead. Pray that we can find mercy and grace in this time of worship and celebration and fellowship, and that we would be able to continue to encourage one another, come alongside each other as we go through the day and the weeks. We are lifting up our young people, kids, the students, those who are beginning new chapters. Father, we just pray that you would walk with them each day as they go through their efforts, their work, their influence. Father, for those of us who are older, we pray that you would likewise make your presence known as we go through the days of maybe testing or treatment or on-the-job struggles. Father, you know our setting and our situation, and we are grateful that we can come to you, each of us. We pray that you would continue to guide and protect, strengthen our missionaries as they serve you faithfully around the world. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. Some of you have maybe already looked at the title. I draw your attention to the wording. You are mommying wrong. Now, people might not be saying it, but they're thinking it, aren't they? Or it feels like they're thinking that. And I guess technically I might not even be saying it properly. You are mommying wrongly. Okay, verb and adverb. And somebody's going to be sitting there going, he can't even use proper grammar. Why in the world would we listen to a sermon about motherhood from a guy? Point taken. Okay. I admit at the beginning, I am an observer of this in many ways. But to that same end, I have been observing working mothers for 50 plus years. And I have seen some wonderful examples. And I have seen some not so great efforts. I can relate to these two guys who benefit from putting on mom goggles. Okay, we have a video that's called Mom Goggles.
Warning, use of this product may alter your perception of reality. Everything looks the same.
Guys, can somebody hit me with some juice? And listen, pulp, no pulp, doesn't make a difference to me. You're the ones dealing with the diaper.
Mom goggles.
Have fun clamping.
What is that?
Have no idea. We got this.
Yep. I mean, think about this. The kids are older. Now they practically take care of themselves.
Understands me.
We're doomed.
What did we do the last time they left us alone with the kids?
Mom goggles! Those things were so great. I mean, they helped us see things like moms see things. Whatever happened to them?
I definitely put them in a place I knew I would never forget.
Great! Where are they?
I forgot.
Computer phone, order 2 pair of mom goggles.
Ordering 2 pairs of mom joggers.
Nope, no. Goggles. Mom goggles. Young lady.
I'm so confused on how I'm feeling. I don't even know why I'm angry, but it feels good to yell.
What you're feeling is natural. You truly are a gift from God. And I hope you know I'm always here for you.
You're the best dad in the world. I'm sorry I don't tell you that more often.
I am gonna cry like a man child at your wedding. Laundry. Look at this mess. It is literally a pigsty in here, mister. How are you gonna organize your life if you can't organize your sock drawer? First, it's unmatched socks. Then, unfinished homework. Then, kicked out of school. Next, jail. How does she process this every day?
All right, one more time. Plastic bowls up top, face down, forks up, knives down, plates in the center, pots and pans we wash by hand. Now repeat it back to me.
No, I don't think the joggers make you look fat.
I've got my dad's thighs.
Don't you need the goggles?
Now, I've seen your mom do this so many times. You have a great mom, you know that.
That's great. Mm. Can you hand me the barf bucket?
Oh, okay, here we go.
I got your cat out of the dryer. You're welcome.
I don't own a cat.
How do they do it?
Cats?
Moms, how do they do all of this without the goggles?
They don't need them. Moms have this God-given ability.
Yeah, it's like no matter what the circumstance, they always see the best version of what their kids can be.
Moms are a little glimpse of heaven.
It wasn't me!
Is that so hard?
Moms, we love you. We are looking this morning at quite possibly the world's most difficult vocation. And today's moms are being asked to do it in a climate where the challenges are daunting. Some of the concerns, some of my reasoning why I even crafted this message in a series about work came out of the results from the Barna study, Christians at Work. Their research generated some graphics and some explanations where it seemed like the working mothers within our ranks fared the worst when they asked about contentment and satisfaction. I've got a couple of charts that I can put up on the screen as evidence, and you don't even need to be able to read the fine print. All you need to know is the yellow line that represents the moms is usually at the bottom. One about satisfaction, there's one about attitudes towards their vocations, and again, the yellow line generally trends at the bottom. You know? And those results urged me to generate our own study. If you remember a while back, I asked some of these same questions in our survey. Honestly, our moms fared a little better than the national average, but it's still a worthy issue, because you're talking about people who are disciples and moms and spouse and daughter and neighbor and boss and coach and teacher all at the same time. You know, in the words of the video, you know, how do they process all of this every day? And if you're not a mom this morning, for the rest of us, how can we help them in this work? And if you look on the outline, there are a couple of arrows at the top of the insert, one coming from the left and one coming from the right. This is my own little concept, somewhat arbitrary. But I'm praying that all of the aspects of this message speak to all of us, and I'm asking everybody in the group to listen to all parts, if you will agree, because I'm pretty certain that some people are going to cheer certain aspects of this message more loudly than others. Okay? And I'm pretty certain there are going to be some parts of this you don't like. No. We always talk about diversity in the culture. Look at us as a group. We're not very diverse, you know, when it comes to skin tone or affluence. We're all about the same. But when it comes to this idea, the attitude on what is the best way to raise a child, that's probably one of the most potentially divisive issues in the ranks. You know, you are mommying wrong. And there's the two lines. You see the one coming from the left, where there's just a single line from the left. They're not overlapping. That represents that portion where we have to say this. It is a whole new world. Moms today are facing challenges we never encountered years ago. I saw a clip where the entire football stadium dropped to the ground. The players in the middle of the field are laying flat on the ground, and the coaches are hovering over them like this, and people are scattering in the stands because somebody heard what they thought was gunfire somewhere. I never once experienced that in my entire 4 years of high school in Green in the 80s. It never crossed my mind at a football game there'd be a mass shooting. And we always talk about the impact of today's technology. Phones are everywhere, and they dominate. And a lot of times we complain about them with good reason. And then we turn right around and avail ourselves of that same technology whenever it suits us. I hate phones. Phones are tearing up the world. We should all never invent a phone. Hey, can you use your phone and send out a mass text message for me? Yeah, I will. If I understand what I'm hearing correctly, some of our modern mommies would like for us to realize they want the exact same thing for kids today that we wanted back in our day. There are these challenges. They have to navigate in a new world. There was no PTO meeting where all the moms got together and said, hey, if we could just have these screens everywhere, that'd just be great. If they could put screens on everything, including gas pumps, where they just bombard our kids with images we can't control 24/7, that'd be so helpful in rearing children. They did not think that up. Today's mothers are not eager for the day when their youngest comes home and says, Mom, why does my friend say there are over 100 genders? I thought there were just boys and girls. Good, bad, indifferent, it's a whole new world. Well, it is not as simple as flatly decreeing, well, if you would just do what I did, you will get kids like I got. No. As truth be told, the people who honestly think their kids are all perfect, that percentage is pretty small. No. And the parents who honestly feel that, and you could say that, all my kids are great. We wouldn't change a thing. I'm happy for you. Praise the Lord. And in doing that, would you admit it's not all you? Might be a lot you. I will grant that. Might be some wonderful sacrifice and godly parenting and wonderful parents, duly noted. But some of that was the kid, wasn't it? And how much of that was God and His grace, even when we were less than perfect? You know, parents and kids and God, when He is invited, are all necessary for every upbringing. You know, and there's only one strand in that braid that is constantly perfect. Because we all know some pitiful parents who wound up with wonderful kids in spite of their own bad efforts. And everybody here knows some wonderful, amazing parents who sacrificed greatly, and kids still made some very poor and very painful choices. And you can look through the pages of your Bible. There's a bunch of moms in Scripture. Are they all identical? Do they do it the same? Hardly. How about Hannah, Samuel's mother? Samuel, prophet of God, anointer of kings, Bible hero. His mom prayed for him. Is she a good mom? How do you judge that? She devoted this little boy to service at the temple. Took him there to live 24/7, probably when he was maybe as young as 3. And she would see him maybe once a year. She'd make him a little robe and take it to the feast and see her boy. And it's quite possible that his daily parental influence was the prophet or the priest Eli, who had some boys about whom Scripture says his sons were wicked and had no regard for the Lord. You want those guys for big brothers? What kind of mom leaves her 3-year-old in that household? Was Sarah a good mom? Presume that she was in Genesis, except for that whole playing out in the yard thing. Mommy, mommy, come out and play with the goats with me. Honey, mommy's 100 years old. Literally, 100. Mommy doesn't chase goats anymore. Mommy's lucky to get you and put your pants on you. You know. Was Lydia a good mom? Text doesn't say. We know she was a businesswoman. And we know she had a household with people in it. What did the stay-at-home moms think of the working mom? Jochebed thought the best thing for her 3-year-old son was to put him in a basket and float him on the Nile River and see who picked him up. And it would appear from the words of Jesus on the cross that his earthly father, Joseph, is deceased. I don't know if his mother remarried. Jesus is seemingly charged with her care. Were there any number of years when Mary was single mom raising at least 7 children? No. There have always been thousands of ways to be a mommy. This is a modern day image that I received, downloaded on my phone. I don't know if you can make out the hinge and the marks, but apparently these 2 kids were left at home alone, locked out. And they had to figure out how to get in their house, and they figured out a way to jimmy that. Those are screwdriver marks, and they popped the hinges and got into their house because they were there alone. Now, that's modern-day abandonment. Please don't report this mother, okay? I know for a fact those marks are 40 years old because I made them. My sister and I got locked out more than once. They would forget to leave us a key. We would forget to take a key. We would come home from school on the bus and have to figure out a way to break in the house. Well, we survived. I was 4 when my mom went back to work. My sister was 2. I had a wonderful childhood. My mom is an amazing Christian woman. You know, and the funniest part to me of these pictures is I just texted my mom this week and asked her to go out with her smartphone and take those pictures, text them back to me. She's 75 years old. It's a whole different world. But it doesn't have to be worse. To today's advent of technology, Man, working from home? Proverbs 31, remember that? The ideal woman we talk about in Proverbs 31 and how busy she is and productive she is at home. And now with this, I see ways where you could be at home with your kids 24/7 and at the same time bringing income into it. It's a whole new world. And there are spaces on the left where those two arrows don't overlap. Now, there are also spaces on the right. And coming from the other direction is the other side of the argument. Some things never change. Ecclesiastes 1:9 says, what has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. And somebody's going to say, well, yeah, but that was written by an ancient guy that didn't have a tablet. Well, he had a tablet, you know, but it was clay and not digital. And it said, this is a response, Ecclesiastes 1:9. The statements made in verses 9 and 10 do not deny that certain events remain unique. No other war had the technological resources that the Americans employed in the Gulf War, right, up to that date. But the Gulf War is still representative of what? Something that has been around, a phenomenon that is not new, and that is war. Are your children unique? Definitely. Each individual, gift of God. Are your children different from our two sons? Most likely in several ways. Are you experiencing what we went through as parents? Yes. It's the same. You know, I love back to school pictures. Some of them are timeless. The captions under these were the best. The first one says, my daughter, after me explaining to her that she'll be going to school for the next 17 years. There are two kinds of kids on the first day of school. See the brother in the background in the fetal position. This one is called Cuddles the Cat. It says, as was tradition in our family, we were taking our first day of school pictures. The cat, Cuddles, had been posing with us in some of the earlier shots, and he ran off. I was whining because I wanted to have the cat in my pictures. My brother, intolerant of my whining, had punched me and told me to shut up. This made me cry. And I started crying all the harder when I realized mom's just still taking pictures. For the modern mommies and the daddies and the families today, we have been there. Okay? We have had kids who were invested heavily in the arts and the music and the sports. Sports are not new. Right? Soccer is not new. I played soccer when I was 6. Okay? Long Train that the band plays was released in 1973. Beethoven was writing music 200 years ago. All of our thespians on stage, you're named after this man, Thespis, according to ancient tradition, was the first actor in a Greek drama in 534 BC, which is ironically the same timeline as Ezra, Nehemiah, and Esther from last week. Spent a lot of time on the field. Do I have life lessons from soccer? I do. Friendships that have endured to this day. I loved my soccer career, wouldn't change it. I still enjoy it. I coached yesterday. Some of the most peaceful moments in my life. I walk on the field between the white lines with the net and the flag, and I still love it. You know, are there going to be some days when your kids have to play a game in a dirty uniform because you didn't have time to wash it? Yeah, they will survive. You know, as a church family, we have leading actors, valedictorians, state champions, Ohio State athletes in our midst, in the room today. And they will tell you, I am confident, life continues. Even after you step off the field or the stage for the last time competitively. But this, the Word of God, and the investment here, that is definitely lifetime. There has never been one time when I thought to myself, man, I wish I would have spent less time in youth group. No. And I know this is a balance. We've all been there. Please do not short that which will best prepare your kids for eternity because you're focused on varsity. No. We have had kids grow up, go off to college, move away. You know, it's been fun for Denise and I to smile at the parents. You know, what are we going to do? We don't know what we're going to do on Friday night. There's no game. I'm like, you'll figure it out. You know, take about 3 weeks. Trust me. You know, our baby's going off to college. What are we going to do? How is he or she going to survive? They'll figure it out. You know, underwear will be pink for a couple of months, but they figure it out. So when you get suggestions from old people, you think, well, that doesn't sound very loving. We've been there. You know, technology might be different, but attention with a toddler or a teenager is exactly the same. It doesn't change. There's nothing new under the sun. This was from one of the younger mommies. Just in the past 2 months, it feels like things are starting to come together. Only a small part of that is the actual schedule I try to keep. Most of it is that the kids are slowly becoming less dependent on me for every little thing, and I think God is trying to work contentment into us. Keep doing that. You know, the contentment piece is huge. They're going to learn independence, and it's going to happen all too quickly. You know what some of us old-timers are doing with all our free time these days? We dust off shelves filled with accolades and trophies, and we box them up. And then that makes us start thinking about it. So we get out the scrapbook, and we sit down, and we start going through the pictures. And we sit under a blanket that is made out of the fronts of uniforms from years ago. And we miss it all very much. No. We might not have kids at home right now, but we know what you're going through. And we do know what you can expect. There are some older parents in churches who have heard that. Well, it's just one date turn into a marriage. And not a pleasant one. We know what it is to be the sandwich generation. There's all kinds of different sandwiches. What some of you are doing now 24/7 with your little ones, some of us are doing with elderly aging parents. And some I know some people who are taking care of aging parents and their own grandchildren at the same time. You know, it's the same culture. Titus 2 has some very valuable teaching. I'm afraid the church has kind of strayed away from this. This is Titus chapter 2, verse 3. Likewise, teach the older women to be reverent in the way they live, not to be slanderers or addicted to much wine, but to teach what is good. Then they can train the younger women to love their husbands and children, to be self-controlled and pure, to be busy at home, to be kind, to be subject to their husbands, so that no one will malign the word of God. And I'm afraid that too often we kind of look at that and we kind of politely defer. What could that older lady possibly know about today's high-tech pressure business world? The need for dual income, it's so different now. I'm not really home that much, really. What can the June Cleavers of the world teach me? And here's the thing. The word that we translate train in verse 4 has nothing to do with teaching you how to download and operate iOS 13. You know, it's not that kind of instruction. The root of the word is the same root where we translate self-controlled. That training literally means to bring someone to his or her senses. That's what it literally means. So that little older lady, that little retired housewife over there, no, she doesn't know how to sync her phone to her car. She doesn't care. But she knows a thing or two about maintaining control in a household. And you might want to admit right now you're losing that. Do I need to put her mom goggles on for a while? We felt the pressure, the consuming pressure. You'll survive. You know, with God, all things are possible. We might not always understand every aspect. We might not always agree with every decision. But we want the best for you and for all the kids. Which brings us to the middle. These two lines overlap the most in the middle. That's the common ground. Everybody in this room, I trust, populates the middle segment, which are this: people who just want kids to love Jesus. Our own kids and other people's kids. And maybe you're able to accomplish that through blessing and sacrifice and opportunities like Lois and Eunice. 2 Timothy 1:5. I have been reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I am persuaded now lives in you also. Maybe that's your avenue. Maybe your avenue is going to be hiking, jogging along the road with a cross-country team, or sitting around a campfire with a pack of scouts that you took on an overnight. Deuteronomy 6:7. Maybe you do it while you coach, or while you teach Sunday school, or children's church, or you serve as a 4-H advisor. How many ways are there for all of us to be active in helping kids love Jesus? That's common ground. Can we all agree on it? If we're going to agree, we all want all the kids to love Jesus, are we willing to say we will put priority on the early years and the years when the kids are home? You know, we revisited this a little bit Wednesday night. We had that comment, children are like wet cement. Whatever falls on them makes an impression. Have you been out west and seen the redwoods with all those big guy wires that hold them straight? No. When they get that big, it's too late. But a little sapling like that, you can move it. You know, and support for this concept's all over the internet. Allforkids.org. Why the first 5 years of child development are so important. WTOP. Why prioritizing motherhood in the first 3 years is critical. Huffington Post. First 5 years of your child's life can shape their destiny. I got a mom and a child in here, Denise and Derek. How much influence does she have over him now that he's 28? Some, not a lot. She had more when he was 18. She had more than that when he was 8. When he was 8 months, she had a whole bunch. You know, and all too soon, that window closes. And I don't know any parents that would disagree with that. But you have the finances, you have the I want to be exercised, my own. Some of it can be my own personal spiritual growth. You know, I'm looking through those. Sometimes on the financial stuff, we just have to agree, we're going to hold off on that. 5 years, newer, bigger, can wait. You know, and that whole house thing, family's growing, what do we do? Got to get a bigger house. Then we got to have bigger income, and then we spend all our time working. We're never around the kids that we got the bigger house for. Can I hold off on a vacation? Do something else. It doesn't have to be so expensive. Kitchen remodel might have to wait for a few years. Bible study. If you've ever been a mom who says, I don't even have time to be alone with God. God knows that. God made little kids to need them. That's priority. This is Gene Veith. He's writing. He said, there was a young mom and her baby kept interrupting her personal study time in the morning with God, and she came to resent the child until she realized what her vocation and her calling was. Being a mom, loving and serving her child. And then he said this, I looked at it, he said, she could read her Bible later. I went, oh. And then I got a note from one of the younger moms that validated the same thing. It says, most of the time, my morning reading, said, my day starts off better when I start with God, but most of the time, my morning reading is the kids' devotion book that I read to them. Right now, it's Indescribable by Louis Giglio. My most consistent Bible reading comes from the Jesus Storybook Bible, but I get a lot out of this. Another part that I've been more intentional about in the past couple months is just putting my phone down. Just that I don't spend as much time on social media or playing games as I used to, and I feel better for it, but it's a choice that has to be made constantly, every day, all day. Choices, sacrifices, but that window, that 5-year, 18-year window, that's fleeting. So the rest of us, all those old-timers, we have to agree, we're going to help these families prioritize family time. I'm going to do my best. We're going to preach contentment. You know? New clothes and new cars are fine, but they're not the be-all, end-all. Bigger house and bigger yard means more to clean and more to mow. You know? I'm not going to judge you by who has the latest and the greatest. There's no rule that says if you don't have at least an iPhone 8, you can't come in here. We don't care. You know? And as a church, can we do what we can to cover the young families? Sometimes there's a tendency to retire from work and things in church, and our argument is, hey, I did it, now it's your turn. You know, maybe we take some of that back off these young families that are trying to do all of this. And I'm sitting there trying to think this stuff up, and I thought maybe I should listen to what the moms are saying. What I would appreciate from other people is this: patience, grace, and encouragement. Another wrote this, to have help with the detail of things. As a working mom, there's a lot to juggle between the demands of work, the kids' schedule, spiritual life, household priorities, etc. Sometimes when I ask, what do you want to do? She says, just so I don't have to think of the details for a minute. Plan the evening. You pick what we're going to eat. just so I can have a minute to not go through all the details. Just extend grace in every situation. Don't lump us into groups. We are all individuals. We all need different things in our life. But one thing we all have in common, we're raising kids in this world that is difficult. We're just trying to do the best job we can. I don't know if maybe the next time you send a card to you have an older friend that's doing a recovery or a surgery or something, a get well card, maybe you send a card to one of these families with teenagers, say, keep it up. You know, I know you might be physically healthy, but it's a challenge. And you're doing a good job. No. Or you're an older guy, can take some of these, take the younger daddy out, take go to lunch, go play golf, go fishing or something, and say, look, do not forget her. This is what she needs from you. Because it might look like now all her energy is dumped on the kids, but pretty soon the kids are going to be gone. If it's just back to the two of you, that could be trouble. If you don't love her now like you did then, before there were any kids. No. I was trying to go through all this, go, Can we all agree God is always able? I don't care what setting you're in. The one note that I got, the days I get through with the most joy and, quote, success are the days when I just count my blessings, look for the things that went right, and know I can try again tomorrow. That's for any family. That's for any individual. I don't want you to say, oh, the first 3 years are gone. First five are over. We missed it. Oh, wherever you are today, we can try again tomorrow until you don't have another day. That's for the mommies and the daddies and the grandparents and the siblings and the neighbors and the retirees and all of us. God is always able. 2 Corinthians 9:8. And God is able to make all grace abound to you so that in all things, at all times, having all that you need, you will abound in every good work. If you're a stressed out mom or dad, 2 Corinthians 9:8. All things, all times, all that you need. Ephesians 3:20. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, he is able. Doesn't matter who we are. Doesn't matter what your plan is for the rest of today. He is able. Able to help us. He is able to renew us. He is able to forgive us. He is able to instruct us, all of us. I don't care your setting. And I would pray that God will continue to do more than we could ever ask or imagine in our homes. And I pray that all of us join hands together to see that every kid and every adult learns to love Jesus. Let's pray. Father God, we are again grateful for opportunities you have afforded us to be in relationship with parents, siblings, children, neighbors, coworkers, friends. We have opportunity to influence for that which is eternal. We are afforded a number of avenues that are temporary but so enjoyable and sometimes so demanding. We pray that we would have that focus, that priority. Father, thank you for the love of family and friends. Thank you for our Christian family that sometimes can help step in and fill the void due to distance or disconnection. Father, we are mindful of times and ways in which maybe it hasn't always been great at home, but we have an opportunity today to make a difference from here on out. Thank you for your love and your grace. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. We continue to encourage, to invite invitation this morning. Maybe if you need to make that initial statement of faith, let's stand together. We'll sing, "O Come to the Altar."
That decision to make Jesus Lord and Savior of your life. You can do that now as we sing together. We'll come to the altar.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Come to the end of yourself. Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar, the Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Leave behind your regrets and mistakes. Come today, there's no reason to wait. Jesus is calling. Bring your sorrows and trade them for joy. From the ashes a new life is born. Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ.
Two items here in the front row for the younger kids tonight. I'm excited. We have real bases and home plate now to put in the yard. So if you want to come, we'll use those instead of slippery plates. And sometimes bad things happen unexpectedly. The mail truck that delivers the mail to the church caught on fire on Monday and burned to its tires. If you use Edward Jones as your financial planning, and if you're, I think it's an IRA or an offering check comes, I didn't open this, I don't know whose this is, but you might want to look at this and see if whatever's in there is still viable, because this was plucked out of the ashes of the mail truck. So, and I don't know what else may or may not have been in the church's mail on that Monday. So be aware of that, that they did pull that out of the ashes, and maybe it's salvageable, but if you think that's yours, you can come and look. And then for tonight?
Brian, I'll teach tonight. And so if you're in senior high, welcome there. And also next week, I believe, is Daniel's last official week. So he'll have probably some games and stuff for that.
Okay.
But, he may come back and visit, but other than that, that'll be the last official.
Okay. Thanks. You pray? Thanks.
Close this morning to take the name of Jesus with you, because that's what you need to do. So let's sing that. Take the name of Jesus with you.
Take the name of Jesus with you.